on, guys. It's K-Dub here with another episode of Crypto Zombie. Welcome back to the channel. Hope you're having an awesome start to your weekend. Bitcoin down in the mild red today. We do have a lot of the altcoins actually pulling ahead. Ethereum up over 3.5%. Cardano up 12% at the time of making this video. We're going to go into the big news that came out surrounding that. You can see over here, Bitcoin was around the $8,800 level. We pumped to 9.2, went sideways, and now we are sitting at around the $9,400 level. But if you've been watching my channel for the past week, you know why the next 24 hours are extremely critical for the Bitcoin price. We're going to get into why specifically in the video. I do want to talk about something that's happening right now. The last time it happened, well, that was back in 2016, right before Bitcoin's mammoth bull run all the way to 20K. Will history repeat? Well, maybe not necessarily, but I sure want to talk about it today. We're going to talk about that. I also want to talk about Bitcoin accumulation and Bitcoin hodling, as well as something that is even more exciting than all of that. Well, for me at least, and that is the release of the Bakkt consumer app. We finally have some details on what's going to be inside of it, what you'll be able to do with it, and I think this is definitely going to bolster in some massive Bitcoin adoption. And if all that sounds good to you today, well, you know what to do. If you're not subscribed, definitely consider it. If you haven't joined my free Telegram group, you can, link below. We just hang out, talk crypto all day. And without further ado, let's dive into the charts. Boom, having a look right here. So this is Brave New Coin Index. We could see Bitcoin got above the resistance that's been holding us down essentially since the all-time high. You can see basically every time we go above it, we just wick and kind of get pulled back below. However, recently, we've been putting in some nice solid candle movements, and it does kind of look like some sideways accumulation, not to mention the fact that we have been supported by the 50 weekly moving average once, twice, third time's a charm. Well, we actually got supported four times, so I don't have a rhyme for that, but looking pretty good. You could see right here, we are inside of the descending trend. This is a very, well, let's just put it this way. It's not an area that Bitcoin likes to hang out in very often, and the fact that we just keep pushing up towards it, it is signaling that the bulls do have some momentum, but like I said, you know, it is the end of the month. It is Friday. We know why that is a potential issue for Bitcoin. Good news, we are above the basis on the Bollinger Bands right here. You can see we bounced above it yesterday, and currently, we didn't even actually wick down to it, but we were supported above it, so this is short-term looking good, right? We are also back in the ascending trend. We are putting in higher lows and higher highs short term. You can see just like we had this fake out right up here where Bitcoin jumped out of it, we also just had this fake out the other day where Bitcoin fell below it. However, we know that right here where basically we have this resistance from the overhead coming to the lower support, this is going to basically intersect right around June 9th. And well, if you've been watching the charts like I have, you know that Bitcoin usually doesn't get to the end of these movements, which means that I would be expecting a massive Bitcoin move pretty much within the next probably week and a half. I wouldn't expect it to go all the way out to June 9th. Now, having a look at the CME chart, you do see right here that we have basically started forming what appears to be, it almost looks like a descending triangle, right? You can see right here, we keep hitting a nice flat bottom, but every time we hit the top, we have a slope moving downwards, right? Now you can see right here, we are at this critical support right here, intersecting with the resistance. Now this is over on the CME chart. I've explained to you guys why this chart is different. It only trades five days out of 7 days of the week. That's why it's very different from spot. However, we do know historically the last Friday of every month, which is literally today as I'm making this video, we do have contracts expiring. And in the past, we have seen very big Bitcoin moves. The majority of them have been dumps. Now, I'm not saying that we're going to dump today, okay? I'm just saying that that's what we've seen in the past. Now, let's say that we just have a nice move to the downside. We might actually get supported again at around the $8,500, $8,600 level and continue sideways in this pattern. However, I do want to point out one thing. If we actually look at the spot and we take the bottom of the wicks on the 4-hour, this is actually looking more like an asymmetric triangle rather than a descending triangle, which is basically where we're putting in higher lows, but also lower highs. And this is also looking for that breakout right around the June 9th level. But now that we do have the opinion that it could be a asymmetric triangle, well, that could spell a very different tune for Bitcoin, right? I do want to point that out. I also want to point out that we do have this sort of legacy, not legacy, but it has been a lot of resistance right here back for Bitcoin. And that will look like it will want to hold us at around the $8,600 level. So lots of potential support around the $8,600 level. Also, one other thing I wanted to point out right here, if we zoom in, you can see that there has been a lot of flip-flop right around this $9,300 level. You can see it was resistance here, resistance again, then it became support, slight support, resistance, resistance again, and it might hold as support. And if we stay above the $9,300 level, especially for the next week, and we put in a nice solid weekly candle, well, then I'm not gonna lie, guys, we might be looking for absolute fireworks in our descending broadening wedge pattern, looking for a $15,500 Bitcoin. But here's an interesting theory from Credible Crypto. He says the last 896 days were simply one massive reaccumulation phase before the run-up to $100,000 Bitcoin, and the consolidation structure will soon be broken. Are you prepared? And you can even see how right here, he points out the fact that even during Black Thursday, our massive capitulation wick, where Bitcoin fell all the way down to $3,800, that is still a higher low than the $3,200 that we had at the bottom of the bear market. Now, I want to give a shout out to Chris Dunn. If you guys don't know who he is, he was like one of the original crypto YouTuber OGs. He was making videos before I even knew what Bitcoin was. So he doesn't make as many videos anymore, but he did catch up with Crypto Potato for an interview, and they asked him what he really was thinking about the Bitcoin price, since he doesn't really make as many videos as much. And he says after the first halving, the price went up about 10,000%. And then after the second, it went up about 4,000%. If we extrapolate that and assume that the third halving price is going to go up by 40% of the prior halving, that would get us to somewhere around $150,000 per Bitcoin. So if you think you're late to the party, think again, guys. He says he doesn't know about the time frame necessarily. The market cycles are taking longer to play out. Right? Markets are also getting more sophisticated. Obviously, as the market cap gets higher, you need more money to move the price, right? But he does say that basically we also do have this economic situation that's going on right now, but he does think there's a possibility that the 150,000 Bitcoin price plays out. He also says, and I'm sure this might get some people triggered, but this is his words, not mine. He says he doesn't think that Ethereum will ever see $1,000 again. And the reason is he believes that the previous driver for Ethereum's price was its use case for ICOs during the ICO boom. Now, here's the reason. Basically, people weren't holding Ethereum. They were just buying it just long enough to get into the ICOs, right? So they didn't care if they bought it at $50, $100, $200, $500, $1,000. I only needed to hold it for like 15 minutes, just long enough to send it over to the ICO that I wanted to invest in. And that was what was driving the price up, because everybody was just buying, right? That is one possibility. Let me know what you guys think about that. But getting back to Bitcoin, let's talk about something that the last time we saw this happen was actually a good thing for Bitcoin, and that's the fact that the Chinese yuan has yet again fallen to the US dollar. You could see right here from Jeff Dorman, he says, Narrative Watch, in spring and summer of 2019, the Chinese yuan fell to all-time lows versus the US dollar and contributed to Bitcoin greatly appreciating. On the flip side, when the yuan strengthened in the fall of 2019, Bitcoin price tumbled. Coincidence? Well, either way, he says, guess who's back at all-time lows, okay? Now, here is something we need to talk about before we get into the really exciting backed update. I was super excited to have a look at this, but first I want to talk about the fact that recently we've seen that over 60% of all of Bitcoin on the blockchain has not moved in the past year. In fact, there's a chart, you guys can Google it. It's called the HODL wave chart. chart. I don't have it pulled up right now. And it shows you that more people are holding. They're not selling. They're moving Bitcoin off the exchanges and they're just putting it in a hardware wallet and basically just holding on to it, right? And the last time we saw them this high was actually back in 2016, right before the massive, massive rally to 20,000. So we had a report from Stack Fund, and basically they talked about the MVRV ratio. Now, this ratio is currently sitting at 1.5, which is a 68% drop from the high of 4.7 back in early 2018, when we obviously had the infamous crypto winter was just rearing its ugly head. Now, they say the ratio in 2019 peaked at over 2.5, with the price reaching its yearly high of $13,800. Since then, it's been dropping. So to quote them, they say history has shown that any accumulation of Bitcoin when the MVRV falls below one has proven to be profitable, right? So basically posting that the MVRV ratio could rise as high as the 2.5 level if this does come about, Bitcoin, in their opinion, could push all the way up to $14,000. Once again, not financial advice, but I would say that Bitcoin really under the $10,000 level is a gift. The longer we stay here, in my opinion, the better the opportunity to accumulate. So you do what you want. If you're waiting for lower Bitcoin prices, yes, we've talked about the fact that Bitcoin could go to the bottom of the asymmetric triangle on the macro. Yes, we could see a $6,400 Bitcoin, but being so close to these levels, do you really want to take that risk? And do you really not want to be exposed? That's a question you're going to have to ask yourself. I mean, Goldman Sachs says, you know, why would you buy Bitcoin? Don't buy Bitcoin. But guys, big news from Bakkt. So they finally have, now I don't know if this is what the final version is going to look like, but essentially we have some details on the Bakkt consumer app. You can see right here, basically this is going to be a digital wallet for all of your crypto and your loyalty points and all these different reward points. Now you might be saying to yourself, what's the point of this? Who cares? How is this going to bring adoption in? Well, here's the cool thing. In my opinion, I think that a lot of people maybe aren't going to use this app for Bitcoin originally, right? You can see you can have all your different reward points. Look, you can have actual cash, right? Maybe you can have it connected to like PayPal or Venmo or something like that. You can have game purchases. Say you have like, you know, V-Bucks from Fortnite or something. Like, I'm just making this up. I don't really know what they're going to use specifically. But it's going to be basically one tool to put all your loyalty points. You can have cash, you can have crypto, you can have your rewards. So think about like those, reward points that you get or something. You have like $2 on a card or something. You're never going to use that. But if you had it all in one place and you had $5 from, I don't know, like Walmart or Best Buy or whatever store you shop at, and all of that added up, and now you have like $30 in points, well, you're going to have that option to convert it to whatever you want. So you can literally buy cryptocurrency with those reward points. I think that a lot of people that haven't taken the plunge yet are actually going to be looking at this and be like, I'd like to buy a little bit of Bitcoin. I have $30. You see what I'm trying to say? And then once you get that exposure, well, that's really where it all begins, right? Once you get some skin in the game. Also, not to mention the fact that they're going to have a crypto trading interface where you can buy and sell Bitcoin. And they also say that they leverage the same information and asset security policies as their parent company, Intercontinental Exchange, who owns the New York Stock Exchange. So you'll be able to make payments, send it to friends. They'll have a Bakkt card as well. And guys, obviously, you know, like this isn't sponsored or anything like that. Like literally, I'm just super excited about this. Now, there is a downside, and that is basically to see if the companies, you know, or the actual businesses themselves are going to have to find a way to basically get this to work, right? They might need a point of sale device, or they might need to integrate it into their current maybe Verifone system or something. But overall, guys, think about all the people who never had access to Bitcoin, never really wanted to take the plunge, but they are interested in having a nice little place to put all their reward points. And then, scroll down to the bottom, there's an option to also buy some Bitcoin. Let me know what you think. Maybe I'm hyping this up too much. Maybe this is just a pie in the sky dream, but I personally think that this, because this is a cool idea even just for reward points. You know what I mean? Like, forget crypto. Just being able to have a place where you could put all of your reward points in one place, you know? What if I had, like, you know, money from Best Buy, I could convert it and send it to a friend or something. I don't know. I'm probably rambling. Let me know what you guys think about this. I'm excited about it. I think this is a really cool concept, but let's talk about why Cardano is pumping today, okay? So the Cardano founder, Charles Hoskinson, has finally put a date to the launch of the very anticipated upgrade of Shelly. So basically, he says that Shelly's initial phases will begin as early as June 9th and will be totally live by June 30th. Of course, as everything, if it goes according to plan, this is going to have staking, right? Which is cool. Now you can stake your Cardano and basically get rewarded by securing the network. And to quote Charles, he says, "I'm proud of everybody. It's been a long time coming. It's been a difficult year because we've had to change the tires while the car is running. What we're creating is basically the world's next operating system." So I know lots of Cardano fans out there. Congratulations. This is definitely a big day for you. Also, big day for Icon over in Korea. They've released their blockchain transmission protocol. This enables interoperability between individual blockchains, facilitating value transfer, service, invocation, and data exchange. So you see, one of the biggest problems, like when you have them all running on Ethereum and they're just ERC-20 tokens, that's not a problem. But every time you have a mainnet come out, right, that actually makes its own standalone blockchain. And these blockchains are not able to communicate with each other. Well, you can see right here, the BTP is an interoperability protocol, which allows distinct standalone blockchains to interact and communicate with each other, including those with completely different consensus models, as well as public and private blockchains. And personally, for me, I think interoperability is massive. I think it's extremely important. That's why I like projects like Quant Network. You know, I really do believe that interoperability is necessary if we're gonna have this future with all these blockchains and they're not able to talk to each other. You need a way for them essentially to be able to communicate. So that is that. But we do have a little bit of bad news today. Number one being that the SEC has basically slammed the hammer down on BitClave. Their ICO raised $25.5 million from 9,500 investors. Basically, it says that they conducted an unregistered initial coin offering and they have to return the $25 million through a fair fund, as well as pay a pre-judgment interest of $3.5 million and a penalty of $400,000. Also, the CAT token needs to be removed from all exchanges. Unfortunate news also from Argentina. It looks like their financial information unit has announced that they are aiming to put tight controls on crypto trading, claiming that these measures are justified since crypto is fueling crime and money laundering again with this freaking narrative. Okay, guys, yes, there's illegal things that happen with crypto, but you know what more illegal things happen with? The dollar. Yeah, okay. Anyway, so the government's true motives for attacking crypto are probably the fact that their national fiat currency, the Argentinian peso, has been absolutely collapsing. In fact, if we just come over here and have a look at this chart on CoinDance, this is local Bitcoin's volume in Argentina skyrocketing. Absolutely skyrocketing. It's the highest it's ever been. So no wonder that they're freaking out. Everybody in Argentina is literally running to buy Bitcoin as we're making this video. There's the chart to prove, okay? So yeah, anyway, but let's end on some good news, okay? This is some good news. So according to a JP Morgan strategist, Nicholas Panagertzoglou, I always say that guy's name wrong. Anyway, he says Bitcoin's intrinsic value or fundamental value is now in line with its market value. So the gap between the two values has now effectively closed after the halving. Now that both values are in line, it indicates that Bitcoin is rightly priced. JP Morgan calculates the intrinsic value of Bitcoin by treating it as a commodity and by looking at its marginal cost of production, including computational power employed and electrical cost. And to quote, "Given the halving of the Bitcoin reward that took place on May 11th, the intrinsic value estimate has effectively doubled." And on that news, guys, that is it for me today. Hope you enjoyed today's video. If you're looking to win a Ledger Nano S, drop a comment below. We do give that away every single Monday. Today's Friday. So yeah, enjoy your weekend, guys. Hope you have a great day. Let's hope that we don't have that crazy dump. If we don't have the dump by the end of the day, then basically all we have to do is make sure that the price doesn't get too far away from the CME close. And yeah, it could be off to the races come Monday. So we will see, guys. If not, we may have one more potential chance to accumulate Bitcoin for a cheap discount under $10,000. But then after that, my friends, it might just be time for Bitcoin to finally have its blast off. And having a look at this chart, well, this is calling for well above the $30,000, potentially $100,000 Bitcoin, but that is it for me. Thank you for coming back to the channel. You guys rock. You're the reason that I do this every single day. My name is K-Dub. This is Crypto Zombie. Until next time, stay crypto. And of course, peace out.